Okay, so let's move on here and let's actually start animating our camera and then we'll do some color correction in a moment. So on our main camera, I'm kind of pleased where it is right now, but we can change that a little bit. So let's click the P key and then I can move this back and I could have this either come from the side if I wanted to. And we are limited to how far we can move this before it begins to be very noticeable that this is not in fact 3D, it is just 2D. We could start from the top though, and this would be easier to kind of hide this fact, especially that I intend to kind of have the entire frame blurred at the beginning. So let's pull this back a little bit, and I can have this start kind of over here. Kind of want it to blur around the center of the frame though. Kind of like that would work. And then we could gradually just, you know, animate between these two points. That's going to be really, really fast, so maybe we'll come like halfway. Move this over here. I'll just extend my work area all the way out. And then from at the very end, or maybe like a few seconds in, a second in from the end, it's going to stop. Let me turn on my title safe as well, just so I can kind of see where those edges are. It also helps me just line this up a little bit. Pull that in. Oh, that's all right. Okay, so we probably need to go to our graph editor to see what this is doing. So let's select these channels, or you can just select the entire channel down here, look here. And what we want to do is if you select these and they all select, you need to do separate dimensions in order to be able to access these separately. Otherwise, it's kind of irritating. I can move my Bezier handles out here to kind of smoothen out this motion. Here's a little bit weird, so just pull this back so it's straighter at the beginning, then it'll level out. This is a kind of weird curve here, so let's kind of straighten that out. Something like this. In fact, all of these could be linear at the beginning. And at the end here, we can just do like an easy ease out or ease in. Okay, so let's pull these out, just kind of smoothen this motion. And then let me just render this really fast and let me solo just the ground and then just the our element text, just so I can see, render the animation a little faster. Okay, so this is what we're looking at now. I deleted the keyframes from the X position just because they were causing issues. And then I just softened out some of the keyframes here, kind of ease those in just a little bit. And that gives us, this is an okay motion. You can spend a little bit more time making something nicer, but this is all right. Something we can work with for sure. Okay, so that'll be just fine for our camera animation for this. Let me unsolo these. Okay, so at the very beginning, what we want to do is just kind of have this fade to black. Let me turn off my title action save here. Let's go up to add a new solid. It's going to be our fade to black. And on the fade to black, let's click the T key for opacity. Set a keyframe at 100%, and then just go a second in, so to frame 30. Make that 0. And then come in from the end, and then we can set this to 100. Go minus 30 to 270. Set that to 0. So it fades to black at the end, and at the beginning it kind of fades into that shot, which is fine. This will actually be at the top. And let me turn this off. I just remembered, I think I want to add like a vignette to this as well. Let's go and add a vignette. Select your ellipse tool, double click. Click your mask subtraction. Click the F key. And then we can just feather this out quite a lot. Something kind of like 300 is fine. But then what we want to do is increase our mask expansion. So kind of like push that further towards the edges. Let's play around with some values. You might have to come forward in your scene to kind of see how that looks. That's a little bit too much. Kind of feather that out more. Maybe just expand that. Just want the edges to just be darker, but not like ridiculously dark. Let's see what we can do. Alright, so that's alright. Something kind of like that. might be a little bit strong, but you can all adjust that later. All right, so the last big thing to do is to add some blur. So I'm going to go to add a new adjustment layer. This needs to be beneath the fade to black. And I'm going to type in just blur, or like lens blur, or defocus. There we go, defocus. And then we're going to add the camera lens blur effect. And at the very beginning, like let's say for the first 2 seconds, I want this to be really, really blurry, or maybe even the first 3 seconds. So let's say I always want this to be at least one. So no camera is going to give you like super sharp focusing, especially if it's moving. So let's animate that at one, and then let's come forward and let's do like 200. So this is going to be very, very slow. This is a very intensive effect to use, but it is very, very nice. Don't forget to include repeat, or choose to repeat the edge pixels. That will help. And we're going to get some really nice bokeh. And we could also use this with some extra embers. We could have some embers that are closer to the camera, and that would look really nice. It is going to kind of defocus really abruptly. Let's click the U key, select this channel, and let's go and just add some ease in motion to this. Kind of ease into that effect. I think that'll look nicer. And it slows down the defocus, or the actual focusing of it. And then you could do the same thing at the end if you wanted to. I'm not going to do it for this. Okay, so the last thing I want to do is then add a foreground embers element. So we've got some, these are actually the mid-ground ones, so I think these are, let's add MG to these. These are BG. And then I'm going to copy the MG ones, put these up here, and then I'm going to call this embers BG. And then come forward. And then let's have a look at this just on its own. Let's go into our particle world, go to the producer. Let's increase our radius Z just a little bit. Okay, and then we can actually pull these forward. Whoops, on the Z position. Let's see what we want to do here. We probably also want to lift this up just a little bit. So let's increase our position Y to make it look like these particles are much higher up in the sky or in the air, and pull this Z position here. What we want to do is go back until we can start to see these kind of defocused, which kind of looks nice. You get that kind of nice bokeh effect. And let's increase our radius and on the X direction. You can see more over here. Now what we're going to have to do though is animate the birth rate, because later on this is not going to make sense if they're positioned where they are. So at around frame 80, we're going to have to stop it from producing anymore, otherwise it's not really going to make sense for them popping out of the ground here. So let's animate it around, let's say frame 50, grab the birth rate, and then at frame, let's say 70, we actually stop the birth rate. Okay, so the particles that are alive are going to continue until they die. And we could even increase, 3 seconds is actually significant. That's okay. And let's just see what this looks like. Okay, so this is what we have right now. It looks all right. I think there might be a little bit too low. So I'm just going to go and just lift the producer up a little bit in the Y axis. So let me go to my embers. Why did I call this background? This should be foreground. FG. And then increase this to pull this up a little bit. I think that would look better. So we just get them, we get them up here, but there's not as much. They shouldn't really be down here since the fire is all the way back there. And I think that's going to actually turn out pretty well. Okay, so the only other thing that we need to do is do a little bit of color correction. Some of these areas here really don't look like they're clipping that badly to me, so I'm not going to worry about them. If you do try this and like this is way, way too bright, well actually right there is a bit bright. So what we probably have to do is just go and figure out which light is causing that. Let's go through one of these at a time and figure out, all right, maybe it's light three. Light 3 is really bright. Probably don't even need light 3. And then light 4 is also pretty bright. Maybe if we just do like 75% for light 4. Then light 3. I'm not sure light 3 is necessary. Let's just get rid of light 3. On our fire element though, let's go to our main fire background. I just want to add a curves adjustment. Make that a little bit brighter. And then I'm going to do on the actual text itself, it's a little bit bright. And since it is separate, we can actually color correct that separately, which is nice. It's also a little bit yellow. This is quite red. So let's go and find that element text, add a curves adjustment on this one. So I could add just a simple contrast curve, brightening these values up. Actually, that really does help. Really does help. I could also go into my red channel, kind of increase the red just a little bit. I could pull down. I don't really make it go purple. Actually, making it a little bit more yellow does actually help just a tad there. So I just played around with lowering the blue channel down just a tad. I think that actually helps. And then the other thing is on this edge here, it's really, really quite dark. And I forgot to actually set this to add. So on the fire for the inner part of the fire, for this fire reflection, you change the blending mode to add. And that will make that stand out a little bit. It's gonna look nicer. And then now it's just the ground. The ground looks like it's not really picking up as much light. So let's go to our ground, close this element effect, and then let's actually increase the brightness and then drop down the dark parts. So the highlights can be brighter, but the shadows are going to be a bit darker. And then this light up here, this main light, could even try to increase the intensity of this, like 150. Boost that a little bit. That might help a little bit. It might also, it would be cooler to have a light that was much, much larger. So let me actually just move this light over here. I'm going to copy this main light, and I'm going to call this kind of the main light or top light. Main light, I'll be fine. Let's just copy this a few times. And then I'm going to just move this over just a little bit. Kind of illuminate this. Makes it look like the fire is actually quite bright. And then we could add, you could change your wiggle expression just a little bit on these so they're not all going to be the same. Don't forget about that. And then on this one, I could put this back towards the center, so it's a little bit brighter in the center, which would make sense. Now, all of these, this is a little bit too yellow. We need to get this a little bit more red. But what we can do is just go into our ground and then increase the red channel. That will actually help that. We don't want to make it too dark in the shadows, though. We could do something kind of like that. And then if that's a little bit too bright, maybe we go back into our main light and then change these back to just 100, or change some of these to 100, because 150 is quite bright. So kind of sorry about that again. Just kind of when you see something, you can't always know exactly what these settings are as you go through these. So let's just change these to 100%. Okay. So, you know, I think that looks all right. Let me go back to my element text, though, and add another curve just to, you know, darken this just a little bit. We don't want to do it too much. Get rid of that. Just a little bit. Right in the midtones. Something like that. You know, I think that will look kind of cool. Okay, so let me go ahead and render this out, and I'll show you the final results again. Okay, so this is it. Hope you have enjoyed it. Hope you've enjoyed learning a little bit more about Element 3D and its limitations and other things that it can do that you might not have known. All right, so thank you. See you in the next video.